Hi everyone, I'm Dennis Foley from Acoustic Fields. Today we're going to talk about three acoustical technologies that you really need in your studio. So let's start with some basics. These people get confused, it's complicated. I think if we talk about the basics, we'll get a little bit better understanding. There's only three things that can happen to sound. It can be absorbed, it can be diffused, or it can be reflected. Diffusion and absorption are the two major processes we use in our studios with music. We do that to deal with the reflected energy off the surfaces within our room, the walls, floor, ceiling, etc. So sound is absorbed or diffused and reflected, and we use absorption and diffusion to deal with the reflections off our room boundary surfaces, our consoles, our walls, everything like that. So, the three areas that we need to address and the three areas that we need to look at: low frequency and obviously absorption. We need to have low frequency absorption. We can use diffusion, but in today's smaller rooms, it's mainly the process of absorption. Middle and high frequency absorption, another common method to control reflections, to get some balance between direct and reflected energy, between direct and room sound, if you will. Middle and high frequency diffusion, often overlooked. Poor diffusion in rooms is a thing we see all the time, and it's one of the four major acoustic distortions that we hear in rooms. Comb filtering, speaker boundary interference effect, poor diffusion, and modal structures. So those are our four major issues that we have in small room acoustics. And middle and high frequency diffusion is necessary in probably 95% of the rooms that we see. Most of the rooms that we see are overabsorbed. And when they add diffusion to it and minimize some of the absorption, they're really amazed at what they can achieve in openness and spatial qualities and definition. So let's look at some of these examples and walk through a few situations for better explanation. Okay, let's look at low frequency energy first. There's a lot of energy in that 30 to 50 hertz range, and we must get that managed. And really the only way we can do that is through sound absorption. So we really have to focus on sound absorption for the low frequency areas. Now, not just any kind of absorption, because this is pressure, not air movement. We can't use foam or building insulation or things like that for low frequency absorption because it's not the right material for the process that we're up against. We're dealing with pressure, not air movement. So we're dealing with pressure. So we need a device that works with sound pressure. Companies use foam as a low frequency or bass trap. That's just it's ridiculous because foam simply can't deal with the pressure that's involved in 30, 40, and 50 cycle energies. So you have to have a device that's pressure reactive and corresponds to the pressure that the low frequency wavelength is producing. Helmholtz resonators, diaphragmatic absorbers, things like that. Those are pressure reactive devices. So that's what we have to use. We have to focus on sound absorption for our low frequencies. And like I said, low frequencies are all about pressure, not air movement. Open-celled foams, building insulation, those are all about moving air through them. Well, a 30 hertz, 37-foot long wave doesn't care about a few inches of foam. It just simply goes right through it. So now let's talk about the middle frequencies. Okay, let's look at our middle and high frequencies. In these two areas, we're going to use absorption and diffusion. And both are to tame reflections. So of the three processes and the three things that happen to sound, we're using two to tame the other, so to speak. So with mids and highs, we have air movement because they're shorter wavelengths. They're rays, if you will, and not waves. So it's not pressure. It's air movement or molecular velocity. The molecules are moving, so they're moving. What do they have to do? They have to move through something. They have to move through a material. As they move through the material, friction is created, and thus we have heat. Heat then is an energy change, so we take the acoustical energy and convert it to heat, and we lose energy in order to manage it. And be very careful with that. You've been in a room that's too dead, that's what's happening. So you have to be very careful with sound absorption technology in the middle and high frequencies. Diffusion, on the other hand, adds air. So that adds air to the presentation, separation and definition, because it does what we call an acoustical magic act, if you will. It makes the surface that you put the diffusion on kind of acoustically disappear. It seems like it's not there. You don't hear the reflection off of it, so therefore you can't localize the distance, how close or far away it is from the music or sound producing source. So it acoustically fools our ears, if you will, into thinking that the surface is not there or much farther away than it actually is. You've never experienced diffusion in a room, proper diffusion. You must do it, because if you've only ever used absorption to control reflections, you're really missing out. And poor room diffusion is one of the four major acoustical distortions that we have in small room acoustic. So separation and definition with diffusion. So the goal is kind of a balancing triad. Get the low frequency energy under control through absorption. Get the mids and the highs defined through the correct amount of absorption at the right rate and level, and then whatever is left, whatever you've created, then take that and spread that energy out using diffusion, because that will give you the most balance and the most equal representation of everything that you need in your room. Thank you.